Members, Happy Lunar New Year. I wish you every success this year. This is the first meeting of the Year of the Dragon. The first agenda item today, information paper issued since the last meeting. The Secretariat has issued any information paper since the last meeting. Now, items for discussion at the next meeting. The next meeting will be held at 2:30 p.m. on the 19th of March. The administration recommends the discussion of the following items. 1. Support measures for small and medium enterprises. 2. New industrialization acceleration scheme. Do members agree to these two items? All right. These two items will be included in the agenda of the next meeting. Agenda item 3, Life and Health Technology Research Institutes. Let us first welcome government officials to join us.
我想歡迎局長同
Welcome, Secretary and other government officials. I wish you every success and good health in the Year of the Dragon. Secretary, please walk us through the paper first. Thank you. Thank you, Chairman, members. Happy Chinese New Year. I wish you every success in the new year. I'm delighted to be here with my team today to attend this meeting of the Panel on Commerce, Industry, Innovation and Technology to brief you on the proposal of the research institutes. According to the National 14th Five-Year Plan, it supports Hong Kong to develop itself into an INT center. December 2022, we promulgated the INT blueprint and we proposed the four major directions as well as the eight strategies. They include promoting life and health technologies and relevant industries. Hong Kong in life and health disciplines enjoy leverages and strengths. We have universities that are ranked the first 100 in the world. We also have different platforms as well as laboratories. For life and health disciplines, we have eight key state laboratories. Hong Kong should better leverage its strengths in research in life and health disciplines to better integrate into the national development to further promote development of life and health technologies. In the year 2022 to 23, in the budget of that year, it was announced that $6 billion will be set aside for universities to launch life and health technology research institutes to foster cross-university, cross-institutional and multidisciplinary cooperation to attract overseas scholars and scientists from around the world. This is to leverage in upstream activities. In this connection, we propose to launch the subsidy program. Now I invite the Assistant Commissioner for Innovation and Technology to brief members on the program. Thank you, Secretary. Thank you, Chairman. We have prepared a PowerPoint presentation. We have some highlights of the program. These are included in the paper as well. As mentioned by the Secretary, we want to leverage our strengths in upstream activities. If members endorse this proposal, we will apply for $6 billion of funding from the Finance Committee. Our goal is to support no more than three of these kind of research institutes. In the past, in terms of upstream activities, in terms of the support we give, it is mostly project-based or laboratory-based, like in Hong Kong. However, this time around, we would like to foster cross-university, cross institutional and multidisciplinary cooperation, so that under one research institute there can be different laboratories to create synergy for their researchers. So the scale that we're talking about will be larger and the project period will be longer. The application will be institution-based for this subsidy program. An applicant's institution must be a local university funded by the UGC with medical school and is offering life and health disciplines. Among the 8 UGC-funded local universities, they are all eligible to apply for this subsidy. We hope to foster cross-university and cross-institutional cooperation. So, a UGC-funded university may submit joint applications with other research institutes. There are some key requirements for the applications. First, an application must be a multidisciplinary cooperation, and also there should be international collaboration with overseas institutions. And this kind of collaboration has to be long-term collaborations. We propose that the government contributes 4 of the funding and university will contribute 1. So for a project, a government may contribute $80 and university may contribute, say, $20. And half of the contribution from the university should be non-in-kind support. In-kind support will be in the form of, say, lending of equipment, for instance. The cycle of the research institute should be long. We hope that with the subsidy from the government, in the long run, these research institutes will run on a self-financing basis. From overseas experience, we see that there are research institutes in other places as well, and they are able to operate in the long run. So after entering into the agreement, we ask the university to start running the research institutes 18 months from the signing of the agreement. And we hope that the institutes will run for a long period of time. And as mentioned, we will provide subsidy to not more than 3 research institutes. We will look at the merits of individual proposal. It is not a must that we will approve 3 applications. It's just that we will approve not more than 3 applications. It is a non-recurrent subsidy, meaning it is a one-off subsidy. In terms of the disbursement of the subsidy, we will depend on the details of the proposals, depend on how we grant the subsidies, but our preliminary thought is that we will disburse the subsidy in tranches. We ask that the applicant institution will have to come up with some indicators, and we will only disburse the subsidies in tranches if they meet the intermediate target. The subsidy can be used for operating costs, for instance, remuneration for staff, and the subsidy can also be used to for purchase of equipment as well as R&D associated cost. The funding can also be used for setup cost of the research institute, including one-off fitting out or renovation. However, the subsidy will not be allowed to be used for rental purpose. Also, an applicant institution that gets funding from other programs for the same items should not apply for this subsidy. We do not want the applicant institution to enjoy double benefit from government-run programs. On IP arrangements, the applicant institution can use the subsidy they get from the program to hire staff so that they can dedicate more time on researches. On IP, we hope that research teams and inventors will be able to get no less than 70% of the IP benefits. We hope to give more incentives to research teams to conduct their researches. These kind of teaching arrangements and IP arrangements are not new. They have been adopted under the Race Plus scheme. On the administrative part, well, since this is a $6 billion subsidy program, so under the ITC, we will set up a secretariat to process the applications. And the secretariat will also be responsible for monitoring the operation of the research institutes. There will also be an assessment committee. The assessment committee will comprise academia as well as industry players and members from the government to decide which applicants should get the support. This project will involve public money, so we will monitor the progress of the research institutes. The applicant institution will have to come up with a governance structure to the satisfaction of the government and the assessment committee. Also, the applicant will have to observe the agreement signed with the government, and the agreement will be set in accordance with individual proposals. We will also ask the research institute to regularly submit progress reports, audited accounts, and other required documents to the secretariat. As mentioned, we are not leaning towards dispersing the subsidy in one go. So the secretariat will look at the progress reports to see if the research institutes meet the targets and indicators set at the beginning before dispersing the subsidy. If the research institute fails to implement the project or breaches any funding conditions, the government will reserve the right to cease to fund or recover any fund disbursed, or terminate immediately the agreement. And this will safeguard the use of public funds. We're here to listen to the views of members today. If we get the support from members, we hope that within the first half of this year, we'll be able to seek funding approval from the Finance Committee. And after we get the funding approval, we will invite applications from universities. And once they get the subsidies, the universities will start launching the research institutes. That's all from my briefing. Members, before I invite you to press the request to speak button, if you have any direct or indirect pecuniary interest, please declare the nature of such interest before you speak on this item. Now I open the floor to members. 4 minutes will be given to each member. Mr. Shanghai Long, Professor William Wong, Mr. Edmund Wong, Mr. Duncan Chu, Dr. Wendy Hong, Dr. Kennedy Wong, Mr. Sunny Tan, as well as Dr. Johnny Ng have pressed the button.
Mr. Jesse Shang, please.
Thank you, Chairman. I support the greater government support for research and development in INT, especially in artificial intelligence and biotechnology, which is relevant here. All these areas require follow-up work. This proposal is in line with the government's INT development blueprint, where we need to focus on the upstream, midstream, and downstream sectors. I have two questions. This funding is about $6 billion. This will cover three research institutes that will be universities. So this will be about three universities getting a total of up to $6 billion in funding. So will the funding be split up equally, or will some universities get more funding than the others? So what will be the distribution like? Now, a question about the intellectual property. the government is being generous. Even in times of a fiscal squeeze, there is support for scientific research. But as the government said, it's public money. Once the money is disbursed, what will be the economic return? Under IP, the paper tells us that 70% of the benefits or more will go to the inventors. So does it mean 70% and up to 100%? So what do we mean by 70%? So does it mean the remaining 30% of the benefits from the IP will go to the government? So I just want to clarify these two points, Secretary. Thank you, Chairman. I thank Mr. Shang for his questions. First, on how the $6 billion will be distributed. Now, as we say in the paper, there may be just one or two institutes, but up to three institutes at most. On how the funding will be split, this will depend on the proposals from the universities. We encourage cross-university, cross-institutional collaboration. So the government keeps an open mind. We need to first see what the proposals are like when they come in. If we decide to fund three different institutes, each will focus on a different area. Now, on intellectual property, as the Deputy Secretary just told us, this arrangement is nothing new. 70% or more of the benefits will go to the research team. This is about the IP benefits in terms of the income, etc. As for the remaining part of it, they will go to the university. In government funding schemes, the government does not take the IP benefits. The government commissions universities to do the research work, and we will stick to this practice. Thank you. Professor William Wong. Thank you, Chairman. I'm a professor with the CUHK, so our university may end up as one of the applicants. First, I support this proposal. So I speak from experience. I also take part in projects involving government funding. I checked with my management at my university about this proposal. CUHK is an educational institute. When you split up the $6 billion and you have to split things easily, we get a certain chunk of it, but there is still pressure. The university will struggle because we have to figure out where the other $4 billion come from. Now, the university does the research. My university is more academic in its focus. It will be a struggle to secure other sources of finance. We are different from US universities. There, they have private universities like Harvard University, Columbia University. They have private medical schools. They can access sources of funding. So my suggestion is, instead of just allowing institutions to apply, can we have a standalone institute first and let it become a private medical school and take the lead in such work? Those are my comments, Secretary. Thank you, Chairman. On the first question, some universities may struggle to find the money to make the matching fund work. Say, if we have three institutes, each gets $2 billion. And this happens over 10 years. So each year, it will be $200 million. Now, 200% of the matching fund that will be $40 million to be secured by the universities on their own. Just half of that will be cash. So that's just $20 million per year for a university. That shouldn't be too much of an ask for a university. So that's for the first question. Now, for the second question, whether we should have a standalone institute. This has to do with the purpose of this funding scheme. We want to strengthen universities' basic research. We want to make the best use of universities' existing governance structure and research systems. We want to enhance these systems without creating any new complicated structures. This is about enhancing the development of life and health technology. We also want to draw talent. With these research institutes, we want universities to bring in the bright minds from around the world. We'll get them to join Hong Kong's research teams, and we form this critical mass. So that's the purpose we want to achieve. One comment from me. If that's your goal, why not have the UGC give funding to the medical schools and expand their recruitment for basic research? And why instead have the ITIB work on this initiative? When we say life and health technology, we look at not just medical schools. Life and health technology covers a wider range of topics. We want to enhance the capacity of Hong Kong's universities in life and health research. Many research in science can help clinical work, such as artificial intelligence. So we take an open-minded approach. We want to give funding through competition instead of by default. So medical schools don't just get funding by default. Medical school professors need to work with professors from a science and engineering background. They need to compete for the funding. Just then the secretary said all 8 UGC-funded universities qualify for the funding proposal. If we look at just medical schools, then we may have too narrow a scope. But I believe the secretary has noted Professor Wong's comment. Next, Mr. Edmund Wong. Thank you, Chairman. I support this proposal. Scientific research matters for our future development. This can also create quality jobs and burnish Hong Kong's brand. My focus is on monitoring the use of the public funds. The paper mentions a number of ways to monitor the use of the money, so there has to be a robust governance structure. So what does it mean by a governance structure to the satisfaction of the government? Will the government have someone sitting on the board of the institute to keep an eye on things? Now, on the cash flow and the resources, this will depend on the research progress, and then the funding will go to the research institute in a piecemeal way. We know that you need a large sum of money up front to get things started. A piecemeal approach in granting the funding may stifle the research. Of course, there has to be checks and balances, but will the trenches end up slowing us down, and that may end up making inefficient use of the money? Secretary. Thank you. I thank Mr. Wong for his questions. The Deputy Secretary, Mr. Chang, will address the questions. Now, on a robust governing structure to the satisfaction of the government, after we listen to members' comments and we get the funding, we will come up with a detailed operating guide. What we have in mind is to require that the lead applicant explain the roles and responsibilities of the management of the institute so that the government will know who to hold to account. And then on internal resource usage, the applicant has to show to the government that there are reasonable checks and balances within that research institute. We have built up experience from different previous funding schemes, so we will keep an eye on this aspect. Now, on the giving out of the funding in tranches, in deciding on the tranches, the applicant gets flexibility. So we can have a setup where the applicant expects certain milestones along the way, and then they reach that milestone, and only then they move on to the next stage. On whether the tranches will end up being piecemeal, we can strike a balance. For research institutes, they may need something like a seed fund upfront. When we assess applications, we can consider the circumstances at that point. Thank you, Mr. Duncan Chiu. Thank you, Chairman. I support the establishment of this kind of research institute. The sector has been calling for this. We've been working on ways to turn research outcomes into product. Research also requires funding support. This proposal can mitigate the shortcoming in the current situation. Some research institutes may be short of funding and cannot get on with the research. For life and health technology, this area has the support from many in Hong Kong. I've come across overseas firms that have come to Hong Kong. They are also in this area. So this area merits our long-term support. Whatever the number of institutes we end up with in the future, I want to focus on ways to fix our shortcoming at this point. Overseas, these institutes have projects and they have autonomy over the projects. They need long-term funding. Our proposal here, or rather our current situation, is that the funding only is available on a short-term basis. Mr. Wong mentioned giving out the funding in a piecemeal way, but some research projects may involve a longer horizon. Maybe 10 years, how do you keep an eye over such a long time frame? The last thing we want to see is delays in the granting of funding, because withholding the funding or delaying the funding may stifle the research. Of course, we should also protect public funds. So here, with this proposal, we need to overcome the old problems. So that's my take on long-term funding. Now on approval, we need a group of experts to approve the funding. In the past, we had projects that were less than groundbreaking. They got the approval. In the past, we relied on just the big names among the applicants. So here, for this proposal, we need people to take a good look at the applications. We need a pool of experts who can vet the future applications in the long term. Apart from the research institutes, we also need data to make the proposal work. Each research institute will generate data. They will also work with different bodies. The research institute may work with hospitals and the hospital authority. Their clinical data will be generated. We should allow these institutes to share data so that different parties don't have to reinvent the wheel after some research has already been done. So we need to think about ways to make effective use of data so that the data can help instead of hinder research.
Secretary, thank you, Chairman. I also thank Mr. Duncan Chu for the comments. He asked three questions, one on the long-term support. According to my knowledge, the subsidy program spends the longest time among all the subsidy programs we have. Normally, we have subsidy programs that span 3 to 5 years, but this one will span 10 years. Within 10 years, we will create success. If there is a good start to the program, I believe the future term government will think about extending this program. We are still setting directions now. We have key state laboratories. And life and health technology is one of the strengths of our nation. In a few years' time, we may get more support from our nation. The second question is about vetting of applications. We have to be strict with the approval. In our paper, we have listed out some indicators and standards. I'm not going to repeat them here. I want to stress that when we vet the application, we will see whether the applicant can ensure that contributions will be made to the frontier fields for our city and our nation. Also, we have to ensure that the applicant will be able to attract top-notch talents from around the world. Over the past few years, we've seen talents going to the mainland, but not to Hong Kong, for example. We want to build an attractive platform to attract talents to Hong Kong. This is one thing that we will consider when we examine the applications. The third factor is that we want to ensure that local experts and overseas experts will work together. The third question is about making use data. This is a very good question. Normally, we want to ensure opening up the data for some state or national laboratories. We have to ensure security as we share data because national laboratories may generate sensitive data for the sector or industry, so we have to make sure that we can protect the data. Next, Dr. Wendy Hong. Thank you, Chairman. I first would like to thank the administration and the secretary for briefing me on this subsidy program before the meeting. They have dispelled some of my worries, but I think that members of the public will still have concerns about the program. I hope by responding to my questions, the administration will be able to dispel the concerns of the public. I visited four people, including one university scholar and one entrepreneur, as well as one investor in the field of life and health technology. And another one is a founder of a startup. They are from different fields. I asked them about their views on investment, and they gave me some feedback. First, they said that this is a good program and we have to continue with our research development. We have to first, however, set directions on developing life and health technology. We have already built a solid foundation on life and health technology in Hong Kong. However, a lot of the research outcomes stay at the stage of laboratory. We have not been able to translate the research outcomes into commercial products. We, of course, have to continue to put into resources into researchers. However, can we transform the research outcomes into competitive enterprises as well as high quality sectors and industry? This is my first question. Secondly, currently we have a series of schemes, including Inno Hong Kong. Some of them have to do with life and health disciplines, and we have also been working with Chinese and national enterprises. We have a research center at the HSITP, and they also dedicated effort into life and health technology. There are six areas under ASTRI, and that also involves life and health technology research. Also, we have been talking about new industrialization acceleration scheme, and now we're talking about another subsidy program that will cost $6 billion. I want to ask the Secretary about the relations between all these programs. Will there be overlapping use of resources? Thank you. I thank Dr. Hong for the questions. We need to ensure synergy between upstream, midstream, and downstream activities. We have to ensure enough resources for research. We have rolled out some policies that concentrate on the upstream and midstream sectors. We have to work harder on upstream sector. That's why we rolled out the $10 billion scheme. And recently, we asked for funding approval from the LESCO for other programs. In the upstream level, we have to reinforce our efforts because we have to make sure that we have enough scientific researchers compared to neighboring cities and regions. We have reduced resources in this regard. For researchers at the upstream level, we have proposed some INT centers. We have proposed, for instance, talent scheme to attract the best talents from around the world to Hong Kong. We have Inno Hong Kong, for instance, but the scale that we're talking about is totally different. You mentioned about the development in the loop, and part of it will be dedicated to the life and health discipline. In the 2023 budget, $10 billion was set aside. And now we are proposing a $6 billion program. This is all within our plan. We're going to work on the upstream, midstream, and downstream sectors. We want to comprehensively upgrade our efforts and capabilities in life and health technology. Dr. Kennedy Wong, I am the chairman of the Baptist University Fund. I'm also a chairman of the Chinese Medicine Committee of the Baptist University. I think that there is a need to set up Life and Health Technology Research Institute, so I myself and DAB members give our support to this proposal. I have a couple of questions. First, can the subsidy be used in mainland campuses of Hong Kong universities? For instance, Baptist University has campus in Zhuhai. So can the subsidy be used in mainland campuses? Also, the eight UGC granted universities are in different scales. I see from government's paper that the UGC-funded university can submit joint application with research institutes and other parties. However, there is no mentioning that universities or smaller universities can submit joint application with the UGC-funded universities. Can two local universities work together to submit applications? I believe that's feasible because that was mentioned in the administration's presentation. Also, in the city university, there is veterinary school. Will the subsidy program cover research in a veterinary area? I thank Dr. Kennedy Wong for the questions. First, on whether the subsidy can be used in mainland campuses of local universities. As mentioned, there are currently 8 UGC-funded universities that can apply for the subsidy. These are all local universities. We welcome local universities working with research teams from other places that would include their partners in mainland campuses. So we adopt an open-minded attitude. We want to foster cross-university, cross-institutional, and multidisciplinary cooperation. That's the first question. Second question. Two or three universities may work together to submit a joint application. Third question. I have to declare that I've left the city university. Well, we're now talking about life and health technology. City university well, as long as the proposal involves development in the life and health disciplines, we welcome the applications. Mr. Sunny Tan, I declare that I'm a president of the Productivity Council. I support this proposal. I support the administration's effort in promoting the establishment of this kind of research institutes. I believe life and health technology concerns the top-level design of the INT blueprint, and I believe this has to do with the RACE Plus scheme as well as other schemes proposed by the administration. How can we attract talents to come to Hong Kong? So we have to ensure success of all these schemes and programs. Just now there were discussions about what to do if there is problem with the research institutes meeting their intermediate targets. Well, you mentioned about KPIs. If the institutes fail to meet the KPI, does that mean the university will get money out of their own pocket to grant subsidy to the research institutes to ensure that the research institutes will be able to keep running? The universities will have to undertake the commitment. I understand that the administration has the 10-year vision. I hope that in the next 10 years, we will see development in the life and health discipline. In the mainland, they spend 10 or 20 years on petrochemical researches, for instance, and they saw results. I hope that startups and different stakeholders will work together and create synergy so that we can see results in 10 years' time.
Thank you, Chairman. I thank Mr. Sunny Tan for his comment. We agree with him. Just then, the Deputy Secretary elaborated on the controls in place during the vetting process. The government will take the necessary steps to make sure that public funds are spent properly so the member can rest assured. Over the years, Hong Kong has built up experience in research projects. Hong Kong's universities also have a tradition of working with overseas universities over large projects. Big projects also bring challenges, but I'm confident that the government will be able to work with universities in future projects. We can see that from the experience from other places. I visited Europe and Southeast Asia. I visited large-scale government research institutes set up in universities. I learned from the experience in those places. The mainland has also made different attempts. So the government needs to work with universities to take our life and health technology to a new level in the next 10 years. Next, Dr. Johnny M. Thank you, Chairman. I need to declare that I'm a member of the council at the Hong Kong Baptist University. First, I support this proposal. I'm pleased to see this thoughtful proposal. I hope life and health technology can generate new jobs and give rise to new firms in Hong Kong. I have some questions over the nitty-gritty. First, there will be an assessment committee which will involve people from the sector and universities. These people may have some ties with universities. After all, we're talking about special fields. So how can we get this pool of people to sit on the panel, to serve on the assessment committee? Say if we have three research institutes in the end, how can the government ensure no overlapping in the research areas of the three future research institutes? We need to avoid duplication of resources after all. Now on the matching ratio 4-to-1, for the university, half of that can be in-kind support. Does in-kind support cover patents? Because patents are a complex item. They are from universities. Of course, cash will be simple, but patents will be more complex. Those are my three questions. I thank Dr. M for his three questions. First, on the assessment committee. Hong Kong has a long-standing practice. Members of any assessment committee need to declare their interest. In forming this committee, the government will take into account various factors. The government will do its job as the gatekeeper. Now, on overlapping in research areas, if we have, say, three research institutes in the end, each institute should look at a distinct area. Otherwise, we wouldn't need three institutes. But you cannot rule out some sort of overlapping as the research goes along. But broadly speaking, there should be three different research areas. But in some minor ways, there may be some minor overlapping, because the research may involve some common areas in science and research, and some minor overlapping shouldn't be surprising. Now, the third point is about IP, intellectual property. The paper does not set out IP as a form of in-kind support. IP is something that the value of which is shown through commercial activities. So say we put a value on IP, who's there to ensure the valuation is accurate? and that will lead us down a complex path. At this point, we want to keep things simple. Universities know well what counts as in-kind support, staffing, equipment, infrastructure, etc. Universities know well what in-kind support is, and they can provide that sort of support. Mr. Ma Feng Kwok. Thank you, Chairman. I support this proposal. I came in late for 10 minutes. I was at an exchange session involving MPPCC members. At the MPPCC meeting today, or CPPCC meeting today, I was going to propose something on how to help Hong Kong better integrate into national development. The chief executive brought up this issue twice. I brought up 2 points. And 1 point is exactly about the proposal today. In 2016, our country released an outline plan for Healthy China 2030. So it's 8 years since the rollout of the scheme, and it's 6 years away from the goal. If we can get the proposal today right, we will be able to support our country's goal. That's where we can leverage our strength and serve our country's need, contribute to our country's goals, and better integrate into our country's development. The dollar sign is $6 billion. It looks like a huge amount of money, but this will be a matching fund. So once you put that together with the matching fund with the universities, that will be even more money. So the question is integrating into national development. One way for us is to contribute to the Healthy China 2030 initiative. Has the government given thought to the question of how we align our development with our country's development? How can we support our country's initiative? If there are such plans, that is, plans to align with our country's goals, will we talk to the central authorities to discuss how we can support the Healthy China initiative, say what Hong Kong can do? Can we have some guidance from the central authorities on our universities so that our universities can deliver better results? If we go ahead with this proposal, how can we better support our country's initiative? Those are my questions. Thank you. I thank Mr. Ma for his great idea. 2 years ago, we released the Hong Kong INT Development Blueprint. Life and health technology is proposed as a key area. We gave thought to the Healthy China Initiative. Big health is a major initiative of our country. That's why we stick to the wording health. Our country proposed many areas under the Healthy China Initiative. The focus of this proposal is also part of the Healthy China Initiative. We do have some areas of focus for this proposal. The $6 billion will be about supporting Hong Kong's basic research. We encourage future research institutes under this scheme to work with mainland institutes. There are mainland institutes. They got in touch with the Hong Kong government. They expressed interest in taking part in this scheme. As we keep integrating into national development at a faster pace, there will be closer collaboration between Hong Kong and the mainland under this $6 billion scheme. Take a look at Inner Hong Kong. One area under Inner Hong Kong is also life and health technology, such as the Chinese Academy of Sciences. The CAS has already set up a platform in Hong Kong. So that's an example of integration into the country. In the River Loop, we're talking to the mainland cities of the Greater Bay Area. We're discussing possible future laboratories. The focus is also on life and health technology. These efforts are in line with the broader goals of Healthy GBA and Healthy China. We look forward to future exchanges with Mr. Ma on this topic. Mr. Peter Xu. I support this proposal about life and health technology. This is a huge and promising industry. $6 billion was proposed under the budget for this area. This money will go a long way. The paper says the applicant has to be a local university with life and health related disciplines or programs. Do we have a large enough pool of local talent in life and health technology? If we are short of such talent, what will we do? Paragraph 14 says that for the IP arrangement, the research teams or inventors should be entitled to at least 70% of the IP benefits. So say a product comes along, the research team gets at least 70% of the benefit. Where will the rest go? We want to give them 70% as an incentive. Is this in line with global practice? I want to find out more about this. If we put in a huge amount of money without achieving results, say that's the case, what would we do? Have we looked at examples in other places, say they may put in $1 billion, how much in terms of return do they get in the end? Secretary, thank you. On whether we have enough talent, we have many world-class scientists and research teams in Hong Kong doing research on life and health technology. In, say, artificial intelligence or chips, we have many bright minds in life and health technology, and this is different from areas like chips and AI. We have medical schools, we have a well-developed life and health sector. But you can never have enough bright minds. We are looking for top-notch scientists. Just like AI, there is rapid development in life and health technology. Other regions, our neighboring regions, are moving quickly. They have attracted top-notch scholars to their places too. So Hong Kong needs to move fast. We need to bring in the best scientists from around the world. We need to bring them together with our local scientists so that they can form a critical mass. Now, on the IP arrangement, at least 70% of the IP benefits will go to the research teams. The remainder will go to the universities. Other government funding schemes in the past follow this pattern. Universities manage the IP benefits from research projects. As I said in my reply to Dr. Wendy Hong, this scheme focuses on the upstream sector. For the midstream and downstream, their developments depend on what goes on in the upstream sector because we need to keep generating R&D outcomes at the upstream sector. We also have plans for the midstream and downstream, such as the $10 billion Raise Plus scheme, the new industrialization acceleration scheme, also $10 billion. But over these years, we haven't invested much in upstream research compared with other neighboring regions. That's why we need to step up. We need to beef up our upstream research capacity because that's what makes transformation possible at the midstream, and that in turn will enable the development of firms at the downstream sector. Thank you.
Lastly, we have Mr. Dennis Leung. Thank you, Chairman. In Hong Kong, apart from the four core industries, another sector that will contribute to the economic development would be INT. We have been talking about what we can do more in life and health disciplines, and we want to transform the research results into commercial products that will bring about economic benefits, so I support the proposal. This program will cost $6 billion. However, there is a lack of clear details of the program in the government's paper. Mr. Peter Xu mentioned about the no less than 70% of the IP benefits. In the past, the Hong Kong government wholly owned the Hong Kong Kowloon Rail. With the merger, the MTRC was listed. However, the Kowloon Canton Railway Company still exists. It's receiving rent from MTRC. And the Hong Kong government also owns shares of the MTRC. If the government is to set aside $6 billion for the program, well, the administration regards it as resource dedication, not investment. However, I see it as an investment project. How can you ensure that the $6 billion will ensure a sense of well-being for people in Hong Kong? The government is going to put in this amount of money, and it therefore has to ensure that it will benefit the public coffer. Say, if we do see results, if a type of medication can be invented by the research institute. However, if the government cannot own the patent, and people in Hong Kong will have to take money out of their own pockets to buy the type of new medicine, then can we actually benefit from the research institute? When the research outcomes are transformed into commercial products, how can you ensure that people in Hong Kong can benefit from these products? In the mainland, there are parties that devote their knowledge, and they get a share of the profits, and they set a ratio to calculate how much profit each party gets, and the government will have to make sure that they have to be clear with the ratio. Well, the government refrains from using the word investment. Instead, they see it as a dedication of resources. However, I think that this is not fair to taxpayers because we're spending taxpayers' money, so we have to ensure that taxpayers can benefit from the research institutes. Say, if we do see commercial products from the research outcomes, how can the government guarantee that it gets the IP benefits and in turn people in Hong Kong can also benefit? Well, the topic of IP has been under discussion for years, and over the years the Hong Kong government has not been able to give a clear response on this. So what is your policy on this now? I thank the chairman and members for the questions. This is about how the entire city looks at our dedication of resources into INT. Members said that $6 billion will be devoted into life and health technology research, and how will this benefit the public coffer? Over the past decades, Hong Kong has been running as a commercial city. For every dollar we spend, we should ensure a turnover. If you look at other places around the world, it is not the case that they put in $1, they will ensure immediate turnover or profit. They look at it in a grand scheme of things. They invest in education, they invest in social welfare, they also invest in INT. In Hong Kong, in recent years, we've been promoting the Race Plus scheme, and we've been talking about transforming research results into commercial products. We've been working towards this direction. We've been advancing. We're just at the start of it. Over the years, we devoted efforts in upstream researchers. So what were the returns we saw? The returns is that while we might be losing some of our advantages, we are still seeing some very good universities in the city, and they are conducting some very good researches. Other places around the world have been putting in a lot of resources into INT, especially the neighboring cities. Let me give you some examples. According to the latest statistics in Shenzhen, 5.8% of the GDP would go to INT. In Guangzhou, 3.4%. In the mainland, overall, it's 2.54%. In Hong Kong, last year, it was over 1.07%. So we did well. So it all depends on our nurturing of talents. So we must reinforce our strengths in the upstream and midstream sectors to ensure that we can have bring about benefits to our society. We have rolled out a number of measures, but we haven't got the money yet. It takes time to develop INT. If we do not make plans now, then 10 and for 15 years later, we won't be able to achieve anything. If you want to make quick money, we should not dedicate any efforts into INT. So this is the overall return or benefits that we are talking about. It's not about whether we can make a $6 billion return in 1 or 2 years. It's about benefiting the future generation. The future generation will benefit from what we do now. On IP, we've had many discussions on this. 70% or more of the IP benefits will go to the universities or the research teams. In the past, we didn't see a lot of transformation of the research outcomes, so there was a lack of incentives for the research teams. We have taken stock of the experience in Shenzhen and Guangzhou. We have to make sure that we are competitive in the Greater Bay Area. So on whether the 30% of the IP benefits should go to the government, we'll have to look at the overall development of the ecosystem. If a lot of research teams can hire people and generate income, and we will see vibrant development of the ecosystem, then we will be able to make money. The government will have to build the bridge and the platform to ensure that the ecosystem can be vibrant so that there can be money that goes into our coffers. Sorry, I'm overrunning here. So we've finished the first round of Q&A. We don't have the second round here. This is a financial proposal from the administration, so I'll have to ask members to indicate whether they support or oppose the proposal. Before you indicate your stance, I have to stress that if you have any direct or indirect pecuniary interest, please declare the nature of such interest. I am an honorary member of the Polytechnic University. I noticed that some members made declarations before they made their speeches just now. Any other declarations from members? If not, I'll put to vote this proposal. Any objections? One objection. 6 members endorsed the proposal. I did not vote. We will pass this item to the Finance Committee. Now, next agenda item, Hong Kong's participation in the Belt and Road Initiative. Let me first invite government representatives to join us. We have Dr. Bernard Chen, Undersecretary for Commerce and Economic Development, Mr. Nicholas Ho, Commissioner for Belt and Road, as well as Dr. Patrick Lau, Deputy Executive Director of the Hong Kong Trade Development Council. Thank you for joining us. Undersecretary, please walk us through the paper. Good afternoon. I'm here today with Mr. Nicholas Ho and Dr. Patrick Lau to report to you about our work in the Belt and Road Initiative. As you know, Hong Kong is an active participant, contributor, and a beneficiary of the BRI. We have been actively integrating ourselves into the national development and assist in the BRI work. With the support of our nation, we're able to leverage our distinctive advantages of enjoying strong support of the motherland and being closely connected to the world. We're a functional platform of the BRI so that we can be a two-way gateway and access between BRI countries and our nation. We have been adopting a whole government strategic approach. We have an office under the CEDB that take forward the coordination work. We have 5 major strategies. That is to enhance policy coordination, fully leverage Hong Kong's unique advantages, making the best use of our position as the professional services hub, promoting project participation, and establishing partnership and collaboration. The Belt and Road Office is also a secretariat of the steering group of the overall integration of the national development. we ensure cooperation and high quality development under the BRI. President Xi, in the Belt and Road Forum for International Cooperation held last year, announced 8 major steps to take forward the BRI. The first step is to build a multi-dimensional BNR connectivity network. Second step, supporting an open world economy. Third, carrying out practical cooperation. Fourth, promoting green development. Fifth, advancing scientific and technological innovation. Sixth, supporting people-to-people exchanges. Seventh, promoting integrity-based Belt and Road cooperation. And eighth, strengthening institutional building for international BNR cooperation. On these 8 steps, the CE said that we will actively contribute to these actions and steps. And last November, the Office of the Leading Group for Promoting the Belt and Road Initiative announced the prospects for the next decade. As mentioned, there are 8 steps announced by President Xi, and we will take that as a guide. We'll also follow the 5 connectivity, that is the policy coordination, facilities, connectivity, unimpeded trade, financial integration, and people-to-people bond. And we'll focus on 4 fields, that is green development, digitalization, innovation, and health. Last September, Vice Premier Dean Xiexiang, in the Belt and Road Summit, made an opening remark in the ceremony. And he expressed 4 hopes for Hong Kong. First, to deepen mutual access with the mainland. He also hoped that we can open up our financial market and complete our financial services. He also hoped that we can further leverage our strengths on pulling together talents. Also, we should strengthen people-to-people bond.
We will support the work under the 8 major steps and also 4 hopes and also our country's plan for the next 10 years. We need to seize the opportunity of the golden decade of the Belt and Road Initiative so that we can play our role as a super connector and super value adder. We will fully take part in our country's BNR-related event and take the follow-up actions. As we may recall, last year was the 10th anniversary of the Belt and Road Initiative. The chief executive led a 70-strong delegation to Beijing for the 3rd Belt and Road Forum on International Cooperation. The CE's delegation took part in 10 events at the summit. Our country also announced 458 deliverables afterwards. The deliverables include 7 that have to do with Hong Kong. The Belt and Road Office is coordinating the work so that relevant policy bureaus can fully implement those deliverables. Members, the paper sets out the work of the CEDB in promoting BNR-related work, especially the tasks related to the 5 areas I mentioned. They are guided by the 8 major steps announced by President Xi and also our country's plan for the next decade, and also the 4 hopes of Vice Premier Ding Xuexiang. Our key area will include early accession to RCEP Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, expanding our trade and economic networks, attracting firms, more outbound missions to explore business opportunities and tell good stories of Hong Kong and telling people about our 8 centers. Also, our edge in professional services. We will actively prepare for the 9th Belt and Road Summit, and we will hold the 1st Belt and Road Festival. With these measures, we aim to strengthen the hard and soft connectivities and also the people-to-people bond along the Belt and Road. My team and I will be happy to take questions from members. Thank you, Dr. Bernard Chen. I now open the floor for questions. Each member gets 4 minutes. Lining up to speak, Mr. Sunny Tan, Mr. Holden Chow, Professor William Wong, Dr. Wendy Hong, and Mr. Ambrose Lam. Mr. Sunny Tan. Thank you. On the Belt and Road Summit, President Xi announced the 8 major steps: practical cooperation and institutional cooperation are on the list. Businesses have networks, and there's a long history to such business networks. These networks can play a key role in the Belt and Road Initiative. Take the textile industry as an example. Our sector has been trying to working with our country's Federation of Textile Industries, the Federation in ASEAN. We've been trying to bring together these two federations with Hong Kong's Textile Industry Federation on exchanges, collaboration, and forming networks. Our goal is win-win and mutually beneficial cooperation to promote economic growth. Apart from textiles and apparel, I believe other sectors also have the capacity to achieve something similar. After all, we offer great product. So how can the government help foster high-level exchanges and collaboration for industries? There are trade associations, but they have only limited funds. The trade associations work on their own for sure, but can the CEDB and the Belt and Road Office support the industries in fostering cooperation and exchanges so that we can have higher level and deeper collaboration where Hong Kong can take the lead in driving such collaboration? Thank you. Undersecretary. Thank you, Chairman. I thank Mr. Sunny Tan for his comment and question. I fully agree with Mr. Tan. Business networks matter for international collaboration. This is in line with the prospects, the 8 major steps, and the 4 hopes. The SAR government encourages such efforts. We have well-developed conference and exhibition platforms to welcome all industries, to welcome overseas partners to come here and take part in exhibitions. Mr. Elchanon Yao mentioned yesterday, conferences and exhibitions are a key part of our major events. We have different funding schemes. We had the $1.4 billion. It's a recurrent funding scheme for recurrent exhibitions. We encourage exhibitors to come here and hold exhibitions regularly. We also have matching initiatives. We help local businesses connect with overseas firms such as buyers. We have not just the funding scheme. As Mr. Sunny Tan was saying, we also want to go global on support for trade associations and business bodies. As we have said on different bodies, there is the EMF, the BUD Fund, we also have the TSF. We're looking at ways to streamline things to support the goal mentioned by Mr. Tan, that is going global and promoting Hong Kong. For Belt and Road related funds, I mentioned TSF, BUD Fund, and EMF. I've seen more than 2,600 Belt and Road related projects. More than $800 million has been dispersed in funding. So we encourage industries to take advantage of these funding schemes. There are different industries, including professional services. They may need government support. So we have another scheme, PASS. It's a scheme for professional services. It's a matching fund. 9-to-1 is the ratio. The government can offer up to $27 million. This is to help raise the profile of different professions. The scheme is there to help professions explore different markets and help them get in touch with those local firms. So there are different matching initiatives. The focus today is the Belt and Road. So we will have the Belt and Road Summit. The Trade Development Council also has a range of different schemes, the T-Box program, the Belt and Road Portal, for example. Much has been done to promote matching between business partners. Thank you, Mr. Holden Chow. Thank you, Chairman. I thank the government for the enormous work they are doing. The Middle East and ASEAN are key areas for the Belt and Road. I first discuss ASEAN. During the Lunar New Year, I visited Thailand. I visited the Economic Trade Office in Thailand. I talked to the business people in Thailand. I found out about the latest developments in the business in Thailand. After Mr. John Lee visited Thailand, we have made some progress. The largest supermarket chain has come to from Thailand has come to Hong Kong, and they may wish to further expand their presence in Hong Kong too. One of the largest families, that is the CB family in Thailand, this family is looking to set up a family office in Hong Kong. For family offices, the stakeholders may also want to have some sort of promotion. So can we enlist the help of these family offices too? Because that would be a positive for Hong Kong. So can the government tell us more about this? In Thailand, the financial and business sectors take an interest in Hong Kong's regulation of virtual assets. Now, the Securities and Futures Commission in Hong Kong will be the regulator in virtual assets. Can we foster development on this front? Thailand has confidence in Hong Kong as a brand name, after all. Now I turn to the Middle East. We have a memorandum of understanding with Dubai. The Undersecretary talked to the UAE too. We talked about listing on both sides. So what's the latest progress? Can the Undersecretary tell us? Dubai is not on the list of Hong Kong Stock Exchange yet for the mutual listing. Maybe you have to put it on the list before mutual listing can happen. So those are my two questions. Thank you. Undersecretary, you may not be able to comment on certain agreements, such as the agreement about family office or other items. You can discuss the items that you feel you can, based on the questions raised by Mr. Holden Chow. Thank you. Last year, the chief executive led a delegation to ASEAN and the Middle East. During the visit, many MOUs were signed. On a visit to the Middle East, we signed 13 MOUs, and then to ASEAN, we signed 33. Stakeholders traveled between Hong Kong and those places. They looked into ways to implement the different schemes. Mr. Holden Chow brought up family offices. Invest Hong Kong has a team dedicated to work on family affairs. I can pass this message from Mr. Holden Chow to our team on family offices. They can look into ways to better implement the different schemes. We welcome people from the Middle East and ASEAN to set up a presence in Hong Kong, whether they are family offices or not. Now, on cooperation with the Middle East, especially financial cooperation, Islamic finance is gaining traction over the years. We have been promoting Hong Kong as a place suitable for fundraising and other businesses in Islamic finance. Our regulatory and tax system can accommodate the issuance of Islamic bonds. Back in 2013-14, we amended our legislation. Those changes provide a tax system that can allow tax bond, Islamic bonds. In 2014, 15, and 17, there were three issuances of government bonds. There were $3 billion of Islamic bonds. This shows the government's support for greater interaction between Hong Kong and the Middle East in financial activities so that we can attract more people to Hong Kong to set up a presence here.
Professor William Wong, paragraph 23 and 24 of the paper mentioned about RCEP. We understand that the SAR government has done a lot of work to push forward our early accession to the RCEP. What kind of obstacles are we facing in terms of joining the RCEP? Is it possible for the for Hong Kong to join the RCEP this year? I understand that there's a Belt and Road Scholarship set up by the government in 2019-2020. The scholarship was rolled out. There are three categories under the scholarship. How many students applied for the scholarship under the three categories? How many successful cases are we talking about? And did these students enroll in programs in Hong Kong? A lot of these students are Islamic students. They have to comply with certain diets, and they speak different languages. And we lack this kind of education in Hong Kong. Do we have enough support measures to accommodate Islamic culture in Hong Kong? How can we tell Islamic students and business people about the measures we have? Also, in the paper, it is mentioned that we will set up an IP regional trading center. Are there KPIs for this? For instance, under the Belt and Road Initiative, how many IP transactions will be achieved and what will be the turnover or the target turnover? Thank you. I thank Professor Wong for the questions on RCEP. As you may recall, in year 2022, 15 RCEP members signed the agreement, and 18 months later, they'll have to finish the accession protocol, and that will have to be reviewed by other economies. And that has to do with allowing other member economies to join the RCEP, and the 15 members are now discussing this. Every time we talk to ASEAN members, be they ministers or other groups, we try our best to convince them to support Hong Kong's accession to the RCEP. Also, we talk to, for instance, Australia, Japan, or Korea through different channels to do the lobbying work. After the accession protocol is completed, we will pursue the early accession to the RCEP. As mentioned by Professor Wong, we have the Belt and Road Scholarship. Over the past few years, the number of students who were granted the scholarship is on the rise. From 2018, there were 30, and until last year, there were 100. So every year we are dispersing more and more scholarships. Also, you may be able to notice from the policy address that the Belt and Road Scholarship quota will increase from 100 to 150. We will, through different platforms, including the Talent Engage, to try to understand students from Belt and Road countries, what kind of challenges they meet in their daily lives. For instance, if they encounter any language barriers or any difficulties in their daily lives, we will be happy to, through the Talent Engage or language bodies or groups in Hong Kong, to offer support to them. On employment support, we will work with different chambers of commerce in Hong Kong, as well as employment organizations, to ensure that students from Belt and Road countries to stay in Hong Kong and contribute to our economy. Professor Wong also mentioned about IP trading. Of course, we have indicators. On IP trading, we have to first improve our IP regime, be it trademark or copyright. We have to improve our regime. Over the past few years, we've been trying to amend laws, and we've introduced different bills to the Legislative Council so that we can dovetail with the development in the world. IP concerns different types of projects. We work with TDC. We have IP Asia. We hold different exhibitions. There, we have business matching services, and we set up booths as well as exhibition galleries to take forward our work. In the future, we will work with the Tech Transfer Office of different universities. There are different upstream projects initiated by universities, and we think that through the business matching services, they can be brought to the midstream and downstream. So we will do the explanatory work with different universities coming up. Under TDC, there is an IP exchange portal. Last year, there was a major revision to the portal. We hope that we can improve in terms of the online matching services. Thank you. Dr. Wendy Hong. And the Secretary, Commissioner, as well as representative from the TDC are all here today. I have a few questions. We've been saying that Hong Kong is the super connector, and we want to connect the East and the West. We bring Western investment to the East, and we also bring products from the East to the West. However, with geopolitical tensions, our traditional markets, including the US and European markets, they have been deploying decoupling strategies, and they see Hong Kong as part of mainland China. This deal a huge blow to our role as super connector. I understand that we've been actively opening up B&R markets. However, what are our strategies? Are Belt and Road countries replacing the traditional US and European markets? There's a long way to go before Belt and Road countries can supersede the US and European markets. Do we have to go through a very painful transition? What can we do during the transition? This is my question. Thank you. Thank you, Chair, and thank you, Dr. Hong. I agree with what Dr. Hong said. Let me quote what President Xi said a few months ago in APEC. He mentioned that the world has entered into a new phase. We have to display diversity in harmony. We have to ensure cross-economy collaboration to cope with the complicated international landscape. As to how Hong Kong can take part in this, well, small and medium enterprises have limited resources. As mentioned in my opening remarks, we will strive to do well in business matching. For instance, some small and medium enterprises would like to set up manufacturing lines in ASEAN countries. So we have liaison with science parks in ASEAN countries, and we have talked to local enterprises that are interested in establishing their presence in ASEAN. And there are preferential terms offered by the science parks or industrial parks of the ASEAN countries, so that businessmen from Hong Kong can seize the opportunities offered by the ASEAN markets. We have the Belt and Road Office, we have the Trade Development Council. They've been offering support measures, including financial assistance. Within TDC, there are transformation sandbox programs as well as infrastructure toolkit to help businesses in Hong Kong to tap the Belt and Road market. There is a lot of information on the portal, including list of suppliers for business matching purposes. The SAR government is duty bound to. Therefore, we lead a lot of delegations as well as overseas mission to go global and look for business opportunities. So we adopt a multi-pronged approach to help local businesses to cope with the changes. To respond to Dr. Hong's questions, our transaction volume with the US and European markets. Well, over the past few years, we're seeing a shift from the West to the East. Over the past 20 to 30 years, we are seeing a reduction in transaction volumes with US and European markets. Instead, we are doing more trade with the Middle East and the ASEAN. So while we are still accommodating the US and European markets, we'll also pay attention to new emerging markets, including the Middle East and the ASEAN, as well as Central Asia and Africa. We will work proactively to open up these markets. Please be succinct, Undersecretary. Perhaps I'll wrap up here. Mr. Lam Seng-Kung, I share similar views with Dr. Hong. Given the global landscape, Hong Kong now lacks options and choices. We have to turn to new emerging markets, which are primarily Middle East and Belt and Road countries. I agree that the SAR government should lead delegation of business representatives to these new emerging markets. With all these efforts, I believe the Belt and Road Office and other relevant parties have gained experiences. Can you share with us how lawyers can tap the markets? Well, Undersecretary has touched on this just now a bit. 10 years ago, I went to Dubai as well as Southeast Asia. Well, now we have no choice but to focus on these markets. I'd like to listen to the views of the administration to see how lawyers can seize the opportunities from new markets. Well, large companies, they have their own resources to open up new markets, but for small and medium enterprises like small and medium-sized law firms, what can they do?
Thank you. Hong Kong has a huge edge in legal and dispute resolution services. our lawyers are well versed in international law. They're in the common law tradition. Our lawyers also know the mainland legal system. I mentioned the 8 major steps and the vision and actions for the next decade. Our country has plans on legal services and dispute resolution services. Under the 3rd major step, the question is, how do you help Hong Kong's professionals tap business opportunities and pursue development in those places? Can you focus on that? So, 2 directions. First, we hold events like the Hong Kong Legal Week. We invite interest stakeholders from those economies to join us. We help them get in touch with our legal professionals. The Legal Week is popular. And then second, we also have the PASS. We team up with our legal professionals and visit different places along the Belt and Road. So those are the initiatives. Anything to add from Mr. Nicholas Ho or Dr. Patrick Lau? I know you go on visits too. You take part in those forums. Just one comment from me. Hong Kong has an edge in professional services. It's a major selling point. The Law Society has entered into memoranda of understanding with 40 places along the Belt and Road. For architects, engineers, surveyors, they also have gone on visits to Belt and Road countries for business. We should help our professionals go global and also bring in outside businesses. We have the foundation in the common law system. We have legal talent. So to leverage that, we need to bring in outside firms. We need to get them to use our services and also get those businesses to use us as a springboard to tap the mainland market. So we want to attract businesses and projects so that our professionals can render services to those businesses. Next, Mr. Ma Fong Kwok.
Thank you, Chairman. It's 10 years since the Belt and Road Initiative was announced. The government has been following up on this. So under the BNR initiative, have we done any study, research on the BNR? Have we identified any parts particularly relevant to Hong Kong, and we drill down on those areas on, say, history and culture? To make the Belt and Road a success, people-to-people bonds matter. We don't speak the same language as most other Belt and Road countries. English is hardly a common language in those Belt and Road countries. So there's a linguistic gap holding us back from talking to those countries. I talked to the Commissioner for Belt and Road about this too. So how can we improve this point? People-to-people bonds will take cultural exchanges to form. So first of all, we need to help each side understand the other. Hong Kong has economic and trade offices in different countries. Hong Kong is an East and West center for cultural exchange. Can we focus on this and get the ETOs to work? Paragraph 28 in the paper says that Invest Hong Kong and the Trade Development Council will have consultant offices overseas. How can these offices help promote cultural exchanges? Because that doesn't look like part of these offices' terms of reference. We have more than 100 offices overseas, when you put together the ETOs and the consultant offices, how can we get these offices to help promote Hong Kong as an East meets West center for cultural exchange? How can we foster people-to-people bonds along the Belt and Road countries? Cultural industries can be part of cultural programs. So what are the government's thoughts on this area? Thank you. On the first question, the BNRI has been around for some years. On the progress we have made on trade and investment and Belt and Road economy setting up headquarters in Hong Kong, those numbers are seeing growth. Starting from 2017, the number has gone up from $1.5 trillion to $2.1 trillion in investment. Investment and business and also the number of regional headquarters, those numbers have all gone up. On cultural exchanges and people-to-people exchanges, that's a key part of the work. As the chief executive said, we have an edge. We have what it takes to support our country's development on this front. On people-to-people exchanges, we have signed memoranda of understanding on cultural exchanges with more than 10 Belt and Road countries. We will work on cultural exchanges, on arts and culture. Indeed, as Mr. Ma said, this is a huge industry. Last year, we held the first Asia Fest, and we will keep doing that this year. We will also support our TV stations to work with the Belt and Road countries and produce television variety programs. That's building on the Asia Plus Festival we held last year. We want to promote our culture through these variety programs. Now, on financial support, we have recurrent funding support. As people can tell from the policy address, the funding will go up from $50 to $70 million for performers to go to those Belt and Road countries to stage performances or have exhibitions. We will work with the Culture, Sports and Tourism Bureau on ways to promote cultural exchanges on top of trade and commerce. So all those ETOs will play a part in the work. Does any other member wish to speak? If not, then I will go ahead with my questions and then I will draw the line. We are supposed to end at 4:30 p.m., so I will extend the meeting for 15 minutes. We still have other business to deal with afterwards. Mr. Edmund Wong. Thank you, Chairman. Two questions. The Trade Development Council has an office in Dubai, but it doesn't have a dedicated team to follow up on tourism-related affairs. Would the government consider talking to Invest Hong Kong to expand the functions of that office? Say, can we have more staff to promote tourism in Hong Kong? Say, promote Hong Kong's tourism products and invite tourists from the Middle East? And can we launch more tourism products? Those offices can also help promote our mega events. I have a question about our professional services. It's all about promoting our promotional services. It covers legal services, engineering, shipping, logistics, INT. It covers many areas, risk management, asset management. I have a question about the accountancy sector. Our sector wants to take part in the Belt and Road Initiative. We're closely linked to the legal sector. The legal sector has done much. The government is trying to invite companies to come here. Both the legal and accountancy sectors have been looking forward to the BRI. We have been looking forward to progress, but not much is happening. So along with other sectors, asset management, legal, how can we improve Hong Kong as a platform so that we can remain an international financial center? And how can we better support the Belt and Road Initiative, Undersecretary? Mr. Wong's first question has to do with the Dubai office. I agree with Mr. Wong. We go on visits to promote Hong Kong as a whole. It's the Hong Kong Inc. We have the TDC. We have Invest Hong Kong and different offices. We have more than 100 service points serving more than 100 economies around the world. I note Mr. Wong's comment. I will talk to my colleagues from different departments about promoting Hong Kong's role as the eight centers, professional services, culture, art. The chief executive has been talking up the benefits of mega events to Hong Kong's economy. The promotion matters. Mr. Wong's second question. The accountancy sector is also eligible for the PASS. We will work through different platforms and associations. We will work with the accountancy sector. We will look at ways to streamline things so that we can team up with the industry to visit the emerging markets and tap the business opportunities there. We can look into that in greater detail after the meeting. What about listing, Chairman? On listing, the Financial Services and Treasury Bureau, we work on certain items such as the GEM board reform and mutual market access product with the mainland and other markets. I will pass the message to the relevant policy bureaus. We need to promote Hong Kong's edge. We also need to tell better stories to attract firms to Hong Kong so that Hong Kong's accountancy sector can benefit. On listing, we can get those overseas firms to come here for secondary listing if primary listing doesn't work. Saudi Aramco is a huge corporation. Secondary listing of this firm in Hong Kong can help draw a large amount of funding. But that's just one example. Let's work harder on getting overseas firms to be listed in Hong Kong. Because listing will bring huge business to the legal and accountancy sectors. Next, Dr. Johnny Ng. Thank you. The paper covers many details. The government has done much about the Belt and Road. Mr. Edwin Wong has already raised many questions I have in mind. Over the past 10 years, do we have any figures showing the number of overseas firms along the Belt and Road that have come to Hong Kong? How much in funding have these firms raised in Hong Kong? Mr. Holden Chow mentioned a center for virtual assets. Hong Kong is attractive. The ASEAN countries are eyeing virtual assets. We may not be able to make strides in conventional listing, but what plans does the government have in new areas like virtual assets? What can we do to help ASEAN countries explore virtual assets here? Now I turn to people-to-people bonds. We have many economic trade offices.
but we cannot cover every place that Hong Kong's businesses take an interest. Do we work with the Hong Kong business people's groups in different countries? Those groups may want to do something for our country and for Hong Kong. I wonder if the government has done anything in talking to the local groups of Hong Kong business people in all those countries.
Why?
Dr. Bernard Chen on economic benefits. I shared a bit of information just now, be it investment, trade, or overseas enterprises establishing presence in Hong Kong, we've seen a growth. The SAR government over the past few years has been building different platforms to boost economic growth. For instance, since 2016, the HKMA has been running the IFO. And this office has attracted different investment companies or management companies to contribute to Belt and Road Initiative. The HKMA also has set up a joint investment platform with the Silk Road Fund, investing about $15 billion renminbi. And through these investment platforms, we've been able to attract talents and capital to Hong Kong. As mentioned, say in the Middle East, we attach importance to the Islamic bond. The financial secretary 2 days ago mentioned about green bonds, Islamic bonds as well. I have touched upon them as well, and the relevant policy bureau will take forward the work in this regard to further attract capital to Hong Kong. Thank you. Undersecretary, I'd like to thank the chief executive as well as President Xi Jinping. Last year, they visited the Middle East to open the door for us. To bring business opportunities to Hong Kong. Over the past year, I've also visited the Middle East and ASEAN countries. I've signed MOUs with different parties, and a lot of deals have been struck. They include investment deals and some capital from the Middle East have been brought to Hong Kong for investment projects in the mainland. We have been working very hard. It's because there are no direct flights to many of the Middle East countries. We took direct flight to Dubai and the United Emirates. However, to other Saudi Arabian countries, there were no direct flights. We had to change flights many times. This was very time consuming, and we spent a lot of money on that. We have resumed normal travel for some time now. A lot of flights from Hong Kong are full. I believe a lot of the flag carriers in Hong Kong have the resources and the capabilities. They also have the social responsibility to open up new flights for the SAR government. During the hardest time, the SAR government gave its support. Should resources be put into these new flights, we should not just focus our resources on one or two flag carriers. Take Saudi Arabia as an example. there are direct flights from Shenzhen to Riyadh. How come there are no direct flights from Hong Kong to Riyadh? Under Secretary, you have the obligation to talk to the airline companies to open up new flights. We are trying to open up new markets, but there are no direct flights. Then businesses will go to other places. Commissioner, if we want to further explore business opportunities, you will have to think about this. With direct flights, it will bring benefits to Hong Kong. This is not just my view. I believe people would like to see more convenience. We keep telling people that we're an international financial center. We have land, air, and sea travel. However, there are shortcomings. Undersecretary, what is your view? Thank you, Chair. I thank you for liaising with the industry, as well as putting into a lot of efforts in contributing to the economy of Hong Kong. For the 8 major steps, the first step is to build a multidimensional Belt and Road connectivity network. Aviation network is part of the network. It's crucial. Because of the COVID pandemic, we weren't able to resume travel. However, we are seeing a resumption now. I will pass on your message to the airport authority. We'll also be the coordinator to explore with airline companies as well as the airport authority to open up new flights. We want to sign more deals to provide convenience to the public. We have an aviation academy. The third runway system will be completed soon. And all these will contribute to trade as well as business. We will continue to work on this. Thank you, Undersecretary. Any other questions from members? If not, I thank the three representatives for attending the meeting today. I don't have any other business. Meeting adjourned.